What if I told you that your favorite online store could suddenly become completely unreachable right when you're trying to make an urgent purchase? And what if I told you that your bank's website could go offline just when you need to transfer money for an emergency? But here's the most frustrating part. You'd have no idea if it's a technical problem, maintenance, or if cybercriminals are deliberately blocking you and millions of other customers from accessing these essential services. Welcome back to Tech Sky. Today, we're exposing the digital attacks that have already disrupted your daily life more than you realize. Denial of service attacks. From PlayStation network outages that ruined your gaming nights to bank websites crashing during peak hours, these attacks affect every internet user. I'll show you exactly how these digital blockades work and how you can recognize when you're caught in one. Before we begin, I need to make something absolutely clear. Everything demonstrated in this video is strictly for educational purposes only. The knowledge you're about to gain comes with significant responsibility. Understanding DoS techniques is crucial for cybersecurity professionals who need to protect systems against these attacks, but using these methods against actual targets is not only unethical, but illegal in most jurisdictions worldwide. All our demonstrations today will be performed in a controlled laboratory environment using our own testing systems. We will not be targeting any real websites, services, or networks. DoS attacks can cause serious harm to businesses and individuals who depend on online services. Never use these techniques against systems you don't own or without explicit authorization. You've experienced DoS attacks more than you realize. Every time you've tried to access a website during a major sale like Black Friday and received service unavailable errors, you might have been witnessing the aftermath of either legitimate traffic overload or a malicious attack designed to disrupt the service. Denial of service attacks are like digital traffic jams created on purpose. Imagine if someone organized thousands of people to stand in front of your favorite store's entrance, not to shop, but just to prevent real customers from getting in. That's essentially what happens in the digital world. These attacks work by overwhelming a target system with more requests than it can handle. This could be your bank's website receiving millions of fake login attempts, Netflix's servers being flooded with meaningless traffic, or your favorite gaming platform being forced to process resource-intensive operations that slow everything to a crawl. When you can't log into your online banking, when your streaming service keeps buffering, or when your favorite website won't load, you might assume it's just technical difficulties. But increasingly, these disruptions are the result of deliberate attacks that affect millions of users simultaneously. DoS attacks fall into three main categories that we'll explore practically today. Volumetric attacks that flood networks with massive amounts of traffic, like what happened to major websites during the DynE attack. Protocol attacks that exploit weaknesses in how internet communication works, and application layer attacks that target specific services, like the ones that disrupted Zoom meetings during the pandemic. Understanding these attacks isn't just academic. It's about recognizing when you're being affected by them and knowing what alternatives you might have when your essential online services go down. Let's start by preparing our Kali Linux environment. Open your terminal and run sudo apt update to refresh our package lists and check for the latest software information. After that completes, run sudo apt upgrade to install any available system updates. When prompted, type Y to continue. This ensures our system has the latest security patches and software versions. For today's demonstration, we'll be using Metasploitable 2 as our target machine. This is a deliberately vulnerable Linux system designed specifically for security testing and education. Setting up this lab environment properly is crucial for understanding these attacks. I've created a comprehensive guide for setting up the lab and configuring the correct network settings. You can access this tutorial through the info card above or find the link in the description below. If you haven't set up this environment yet, please do so before continuing with this demonstration. The lab setup ensures you're testing in a safe, controlled environment with proper network isolation. Once your environment is ready, verify that both your Kali Linux machine and Metasploitable 2 are running on the same network segment for our testing. Our first demonstration will be a volumetric attack, specifically an ICMP flood. Volumetric attacks aim to consume the bandwidth of the target network or the resources of network equipment by sending massive amounts of traffic. ICMP, which stands for Internet Control Message Protocol, operates at layer 3 of the OSI model, the network layer. This protocol is typically used for network diagnostics and error reporting, such as when you use the ping command to test connectivity. First, let's establish our target. On the Metasploitable 2 machine, run ifconfig to identify the IP address. Make note of this address as it will be our attack target. Before launching our attack, let's examine the current ICMP statistics on the target machine. Run netstat-spipegrep-iicmp to display ICMP-related network statistics. The netstat command shows network statistics. The -s flag displays statistics for all protocols, and we're using grep to filter for ICMP-related entries. Notice that all ICMP counters are currently at zero, indicating no recent ICMP activity. Now, from our Kali Linux attacker machine, let's verify connectivity to the target. Run ping-c4, followed by the target IP address. The ping command sends ICMP echo requests to test connectivity. The -c4 flag limits the test to 4 packets. You should see successful responses, indicating that both machines can communicate with each other. If you return to the target machine and run the netstat command again, you'll now see that 4 ICMP packets were received and 4 were sent, confirming the successful ping test. Now, let's launch our ICMP flood attack. From the Kali machine, run sudo hping3--icmp--flood--ran-source, followed by the target IP address. Let me break down this command. Hping3 is a powerful packet crafting tool that can generate custom network packets. ICMP specifies that we're sending ICMP packets. Flood tells Hping3 to send packets as fast as possible without waiting for replies. RAN-source randomizes the source IP addresses to make the attack harder to block. Once the attack starts, switch to the target machine to observe the impact. Run sudo tcpdump ICMP to capture and display ICMP traffic in real time. The tcpdump command captures network packets and specifying ICMP filters to show only ICMP traffic. You'll see a continuous flood of ICMP packets hitting the target machine. This demonstrates why it's called a volumetric attack. The sheer volume of packets can overwhelm network resources. Since ICMP operates at the network layer, this attack can consume bandwidth and processing power of network devices like routers and firewalls. You might notice the target machine becoming less responsive due to the resources being consumed by processing the flood of ICMP packets. Stop the packet capture with Ctrl-C and run the netstat command again. You'll see dramatically increased ICMP packet counts, showing the impact of our attack. Return to the attacker machine and stop the attack by pressing Ctrl-C. Our second demonstration focuses on protocol attacks, specifically a SYN flood attack. Protocol attacks exploit weaknesses in network protocols, typically operating at layer 4 of the OSI model, the transport layer. SYN flood attacks target the TCP handshake process. When a client wants to establish a TCP connection, it sends a SYN packet to the server. The server responds with a SYN ACK packet and waits for the client's ACK to complete the handshake. A SYN flood sends many SYN packets, but never completes the handshake, leaving the server with many half-open connections that consume resources. Before launching our attack, we need reconnaissance to identify open ports on our target. Ports are the entry points for network services, and attacking specific ports can be more effective than random attacks. From the Kali machine, run nmap-ss-pn, followed by the target IP address. This nmap command performs a SYN scan -SS, which is stealthy and fast, and -PN tells Nmap to skip host discovery and scan directly. Nmap will identify which ports are open and accepting connections. You should see several open ports, including port 80, which typically hosts web services. We'll target port 80 for our demonstration. Now let's launch our SYN flood attack. Run sudo hping 3-s-p80-flood-ran-source, followed by the target IP address. Breaking down this command, -s specifies SYN packets and -p80 targets port 80 specifically. The other flags we've already discussed earlier. They control the packet rate and randomize the source IPs to evade basic filtering. To observe the attack's impact, switch to the target machine and run netstat-ant-pipe-grep-isyn-receive. This command shows network connections and filters for connections in the syn-receive state. These are connections waiting for the final ACK to complete the TCP handshake. You'll see a continuous stream of connections in the syn-receive state, indicating that the server is overwhelmed with incomplete connection attempts. This consumes server resources and can prevent legitimate users from establishing connections. Return to the attacker machine and stop the attack with Ctrl-C. If you check the target machine again, you'll see that the list of syn-receive connections stops growing. This attack is particularly effective because it exploits a fundamental aspect of how TCP connections work, making it difficult to distinguish between legitimate connection attempts and attack traffic. Our final demonstration covers application layer attacks, specifically, a slow HTTP attack operating at layer 7 of the OSI model, the application layer. These attacks target specific applications and services rather than overwhelming network infrastructure. Slow HTTP attacks are particularly insidious because they use very little bandwidth while being highly effective. Instead of flooding the target with traffic, they establish legitimate connections but send data very slowly, keeping connections open and eventually exhausting the server's connection pool. First, we need to identify web applications running on our target. Our Metasploitable 2 machine hosts several vulnerable web applications for testing purposes. Open a web browser and enable private browsing mode by pressing Ctrl-Shift-P. Private browsing prevents caching, which is important for accurately testing the attack's impact. Navigate to the target IP address followed by /mutilidae. You should see a web application interface, confirming that the service is accessible and functional. Copy this complete URL as we'll need it for our attack. Now we need to install our attack tool. In the terminal, type slow HTTP test. If the tool isn't installed, the system will offer to install it. Type Y to proceed with the installation. Slow HTTP test is specifically designed to perform various slow HTTP attacks that can test web server resilience against application layer DoS attacks. Once installed, launch the attack with slow HTTP test -c1000-h-u, followed by the web application URL you copied. Let me explain this command. -c1000 specifies 1000 concurrent connections. -h enables slow HTTP headers mode, where the tool sends headers very slowly. -u specifies the target URL. The tool will begin establishing connections and display real-time statistics, including the number of connections, response status, and service availability. Initially, you'll see the service status as yes, indicating the web application is accessible. As the attack progresses and consumes server resources, this status will change to no. To verify the attack's impact, return to your browser and try to access the web application again. You'll notice that the page either loads extremely slowly with a spinning cursor or fails to load entirely with timeout errors. This demonstrates the effectiveness of application layer attacks. With relatively few resources and minimal bandwidth, an attacker can render a web service completely unavailable to legitimate users. The attack works by exhausting the web server's connection pool, preventing it from serving new requests, even though the server itself isn't technically overwhelmed with traffic. Stop the attack by pressing Ctrl-C in the terminal, then try accessing the web application again. After a few moments, the service should become available again as the server releases the held connections. Remember, the knowledge shared in this video is meant to help you understand these threats and protect against them, never to cause harm. Using these techniques against real people is illegal and can result in serious criminal charges. If you found this demonstration valuable for your security awareness, smash that like button right now. Understanding these attack methods is crucial for protecting yourself and your loved ones. Hit subscribe and turn on notifications so you never miss our latest security insights and protection strategies. Consider becoming a channel member by clicking the join button above. Share this video with friends and family. The more people recognize these attacks, the less effective they become. We're constantly working on new content covering the latest attack methods and protection strategies. Your feedback and suggestions directly influence what topics we cover next. Remember, in our interconnected world, cybersecurity isn't just about protecting data. It's about protecting your privacy, your safety, and your peace of mind. Until next time, stay curious, stay protected, and keep learning. This is TechSky, signing off.